Well, welcome everyone. My name is Tim Palm, Director of Bands. Actually, I know most everybody. I guess I know everybody. So, and I want to welcome. This is our Music for All series. In this installment is Dr. Isaac Smith and playing higher, I can say the correct way, and the way to be successful, which he's the model of that here at IUP in our music department. An alum who's done well and treated everybody else well here and creating great trumpet players. And now we're sharing once again with the series. So please welcome Dr. Isaac Smith.
Nice to be here today. I'm actually going to show my limited technological prowess by sharing a recording with you right now, I hope. So let's see if we can all hear this. That was a recording I made more years ago than I care to admit. I won't tell you the year, but that was a recording of me playing. So what we want to talk about today is range on the trumpet, building range on the trumpet. I will be referring to a handout, a PDF that I've created. And after this session, I will share a copy of this PDF with all of you. So if you want to take notes, you're more than welcome to, but know that I will be sharing a copy of this PDF, including all of the exercises that I'll be talking about. Range is one of the many techniques that trumpet players need to develop. We must develop things like lip flexibility, finger dexterity, articulation, which includes not only single tonguing, but double tonguing and triple tonguing. Sight reading is a technique that all of us need to develop. Later on, you may work on transposition. If you like jazz, you may work on improvisation. And so these are all things that we need to continue to work on and develop. But as I work with students and as I ask students, what is it that you feel that you need to work on and develop to a greater degree? Almost to a person, the answer is high notes. I need to work on my range. Now, whether this is because they feel pressure from other players or from their band directors, or because they've listened to professional trumpet players on recordings, whatever the reason is, it seems like every trumpet player I work with wants to learn how to develop their range, their upper register. And I think there are both good ways and bad ways to pursue playing higher notes on the trumpet. Here are some of the bad ways: excessive mouthpiece pressure or force. In a worst case scenario, this can actually lead to the permanent damaging of the lips. If you don't believe me, look at a picture of Louis Armstrong later in his life. He created such pressure and played for such long periods of time that he actually ruptured the orbicularis oris. That's the name of the lip, of the muscle that makes up the lip. He used so much pressure that he actually tore the muscle and had to change his embouchure later in life. I've known other trumpet players who have suffered from this problem. In fact, there is a surgeon in Toronto, Canada, who specializes in the reattachment of the orbicularis oris. We don't want to go there. We do not want to create permanent damage to the lip muscle. But know that excessive force can also create problems with tone quality, with intonation, with flexibility, and even with response. Some trumpet players will try and play higher notes by shifting their embouchure. So they'll take their mouthpiece, and instead of playing it essentially in the middle of the face, they'll use very little upper lip. And they'll pull down, I'll get close to the camera, so that there's very little upper lip. This seems to work because, there's less lip to vibrate. And the result is a faster vibration of the lips. Some players develop an upstream, a jutting jaw kind of embouchure. You see this a lot in jazz players. Or they'll look like they're smiling when they play because they stretch the lips, much like stretching a rubber band. And these things also impact tone quality, intonation, flexibility, and response. A favorite one is to use a smaller mouthpiece. In my day, it was a jet tone mouthpiece, a very, very small, very, very shallow mouthpiece, because you're trying to push a lot of meat into a mouthpiece that isn't willing to accept all of that meat. The result is the lips are very crammed together. They vibrate fast. No flexibility, poor tone quality, poor intonation. And in this day and age, it's probably the Schottky 14A4A. I see a lot of students who will switch to a jazz mouthpiece or to a lead mouthpiece. And sometimes their regular mouthpiece is a Bach. And instead of staying with a Bach mouthpiece, they switch to a Schottky. And the rim configuration is different, and this can also lead to inconsistency or problems. Signs of tension and force: red faces, bulging cheeks and eyes, protruding veins, an expanding neck. All of these things mean that you're limiting the flow of air instead of allowing for a greater flow of air. If you try and push a lot of air out of a hole that doesn't exist or a very small hole, the result is back pressure. This results in poor tone quality, poor intonation, poor response, poor flexibility, limited endurance, and also an inability to play higher notes, an inability to play lower notes. So you can't really play very high, but now you've lost your lower register. Know that nothing takes the place of practice. There's nothing magical. There's nothing mysterious about high notes. The bad news is there are no shortcuts to developing range. If you want to develop your range, you must learn to be patient. You must learn to be methodical. You must learn to be disciplined. but there are no magical shortcuts. If anyone tells you that you can play a double high C in 10 minutes, it's not possible unless you severely alter your approach to playing. And that's not going to help you with any other type of playing that you're trying to do. So the purpose of today is not to tell you all the things not to do, but to tell you the things that you should be doing. I will tell you that baseball players, especially pitching coaches, don't want to teach young students how to pitch a curveball. You don't want young children lifting really heavy weights or running for long periods of time, because these overstress young and developing muscles. And likewise, young trumpet players should not be forced to overextend themselves when it comes to range. Everyone has the capacity to play the trumpet, and some people have a naturally easier time with higher notes than others. For the rest of us, we have to practice. We have to develop our skills. So if you listen to the latest Incredibles movie and you said, I want to play like Wayne Bergeron, the answer is you have to practice a lot, and you may never sound like Wayne Bergeron. Just as you may go jogging, but it doesn't mean that you can run fast enough to be in the next Olympics. So this is about logical, consistent, patient practice over the longer period of time. So we start with slow and methodical practice. And for me, there are two types of exercises that I like to engage in to build my sense of consistency in the upper register. The first is scales. Now, I know for some students, scales is a four-letter word, but I practice scales a lot. And lip flexibilities. And I will be giving examples of all of those things in a little bit. I like to use minimal mouthpiece pressure. I cannot gauge mouthpiece pressure. I do not have a gauge on my trumpet, which indicates whether I'm using 2 pounds of force, 20 pounds of force, 200 pounds of force. I simply have to make sure that I'm not pressing so hard that it distracts or disturbs my flexibility, my response, my tone quality, my intonation. I'm trying to create the best sound that I can, regardless of the range that I'm playing in. A normal embouchure, which for me is centered both vertically and horizontally. I want half upper lip, half lower lip. I want it to be in the center. Now, if you watch me play, I play slightly off to the right side of center, and that's because of my teeth. I grew up in an age before orthodontists ruled the world, and so my teeth are crooked. The best place for my embouchure is slightly off center, and I'm willing to allow my students to likewise play slightly off center if it's comfortable for them. But for all intents and purposes, my younger students, I want them to be centered both vertically and horizontally. I also want them to use a normal mouthpiece. That's a mouthpiece that is not for, that's not too small, that's not too shallow, because I think most students, at least through high school, aren't ready to have a jazz or a lead mouthpiece, a commercial mouthpiece. They need one mouthpiece to develop musculature and what I refer to as the ring of muscle, and that's where the mouthpiece fits on their face. For youngest players, that's a box 7C or its equivalent. In high school, that's probably switching to either a 5 or a 3C or its equivalent. And then only students who have larger capacities in terms of their air and larger lips, I might recommend a box 1.5C. But I have college students who go all through college with a box 3C or its equivalent. So I don't think that we need to mess around with equipment too much, at least for younger players. The correct approach requires proper technical knowledge, which I'm going to share with you today, and then the muscular development of the individual. I like to refer to my students as athletes. An athlete is someone who understands the technique of a particular event and then builds musculature so they're able to accomplish that technique more easily. Are there any questions or anything to this point? Then I will continue on with regards to technique. The first technique that I want to talk about in terms of development of upper register is the use of air. No one studies with me for very long before they hear that word, air. A higher note, as I said earlier, is not magical. It's not mystical. It is a faster vibration. A higher note is simply a faster frequency, a faster vibration. I don't like using the word high notes, by the way, because most of my students infer that high is hard. So when they talk about a high C, what they're really telling me is it's a hard C, as opposed to third space C, as opposed to low C. A hard C automatically creates the effect that note is going to be more difficult to achieve. And so I talk about the C above the staff, or the F above C above the staff, but I try and avoid using the word high because the connotation is that's the hard note, that's the hard C, that's the hard F. But a higher note, a note that is in the upper register of our instrument, requires a faster vibration of the lips. You can get a faster vibration of the lips if you press the mouthpiece harder against the lips, limiting its ability to vibrate. That hurts, and I don't like doing it. Instead, I talk about using faster air, or at least I used to until about 5 or 7 years ago when I realized that faster is hard to quantify. It's difficult for me to say your air should be going 7 miles an hour. Your air should be going 12 miles an hour. I can't conceptualize of that. And so it's difficult to tell a student to use faster air without any sort of further description. So I've started referring to air that goes farther, air that goes farther. And I start with a minimum length of air. Most of you should know, all of you should know, that the overall length of a B-flat trumpet is 4 feet, 6 inches of tubing. From the mouthpiece to the bell, you're talking about a tube that is 4 feet, 6 inches long. So my imagery is now of air that's traveling at least 4 feet, 6 inches. So I imagine a piece of paper, I imagine a candle that exists 4 feet, 6 inches from my lips. My goal is to make that candle flame flicker. It's not to blow out the candle. I'm not talking about an explosive use of air, but simply a steady, constant stream of air so that that candle that's 4 feet, 6 inches away will begin to flicker because of the air. Or a piece of paper that's suspended from the ceiling, it begins to flutter. So for me, that's what I tell my students in terms of a minimum effort. So with younger students, I'm trying to get that imagery. I'm constantly holding my index finger about 4.5 feet from their lips, and I'm saying, this is the candle flame. See if you can make it flicker. See if you can make it flicker. Again, not blow it out, but simply make it flicker. The result is air that is more active, a vibration that is purer because you're putting more energy into the instrument. The truth is, it doesn't take a great deal of air to play the trumpet. Air does not go flying out of the end of the bell. Most of us are using bell covers right now, but the truth is, experiments with regard to aerosols show that air travels maybe about 2 feet past the bell and then begins to curve upward. And the reason that it curves upward is because we're all approximately 98.6 on the inside. And that's warmer than the air around us right now. So the air goes out and then begins to curl upward because it's warmer air and warm air rises. So the idea of aerosols and basically spewing these aerosols across a room, it is not really true. It's a fallacy. When you cough, you're using a much greater amount of air to produce that cough than you ever do to play the trumpet. But once I can convince a student to use a minimum of 4 feet, 6 inches worth of tubing, and again, this is imagery, not necessarily reality, as I want them to play a higher note, as I want them to play a louder note, as I want them to play a faster note in terms of rhythm, I tell them that the air should go farther. So now I hold my finger 6 feet away from the student's lips, 8 feet away, 10 feet away. So my concept is one of air that has a greater energy. The effort doesn't come from the face. The effort comes from that area that when we play the trumpet, we refer to as the diaphragmatic region. It's this sense of taking air and propelling it a farther distance. So these are the images that I use when I am working with my trumpet players. I also tell them to imagine that as they play higher, that the air also goes higher. What happens is this causes the jaw to come down and forward. And what that does is that preserves the embouchure as it exists. If you start to clench your muscles, if you start to tighten up, what happens is the jaw recedes. And now suddenly the air is going down over the chin. There's an overlap of the upper lip to the lower lip, and you've lost your aperture, aperture being the hole between the lip that the air comes through. So I trick myself by thinking my air higher. Now, you can all feel sorry for me. I have never in my life had bangs. I've never had hair that hung over my eyes that I had to get out of the way. But for those of you who have had bangs, the idea of blowing up over your nose to blow the hair out of your eyes is what I'm thinking of as I play the highest notes in my register. So not only is my air going farther, my air is going higher. The result is my jaw stays down and forward. Both my upper lip and my lower lip are contributing to the vibration. The speed of the air creates a faster vibration. That, ladies and gentlemen, is a higher note. It's just no harder than that. Did that bring up any questions or comments? So in addition to air, in terms of technique, the next thing is the development of musculature. There are 26 muscles in your face that do something when you buzz your lips. 26 muscles, 13 pairs of muscles. And in fact, let me share with you this graphic. My wife is a nurse practitioner, and she used to study kinesiology. For those of you who don't know what kinesiology is, that is the study of muscles. She used to have these disgusting books at home that had cadavers with their skin peeled away, and she would have to identify the various muscle groups. In high school, I had to dissect a cat. Don't ever want to do that again. But in terms of the musculature, I want you to be aware that there are 26 muscles, 13 pairs of muscles that must do something in order for you to create an embouchure. And you should all now be able to see this graphic. Are you able to see that? Somebody give me a thumbs up. Good. So we've got the zygomaticus major, the zygomaticus minor, the buccinator, the risorius. You're welcome to memorize these if you want to. I don't think that you need to. But notice that they all look like they're pointing into the middle, just like the spokes of a tire. If you have a bicycle tire, you have all of these spokes that point into the hub of the tire, and that hub is what then attaches the tire to the bicycle. And when you ride, you have a smooth, even ride. If any of you have ever ridden a bicycle that's missing a couple of these spokes, the ride is very uneven. And in fact, because the other spokes then have additional pressure put on them, I've already been riding an old bike and suddenly all of the spokes let go and I wound up on the street on my behind because the tire simply gave way. So much like the tire, I want the 26 muscles in my face to all point into the middle. We refer to the middle of the embouchure as the aperture. The aperture, by my definition, is the hole between your lips that the air comes through. And all of the muscles that surround the lips, all the muscles that surround the aperture are then the embouchure. Not necessarily where you put your mouthpiece on your face, but how you form that area where you rest your mouthpiece is what I think is important for us to continue to talk about. So did that bring up any questions? There are all kinds of different embouchure strengthening devices which you can buy if you want to. Somebody several years ago got really cute and decided to create a series of metal rods with little plastic covers, and they called them chopsticks. C-H-O-P, sticks is S-T-I-K-S, chopsticks. The smaller one weighs less, and the objective is to put this where your aperture is. And hold it in place. This is an isometric exercise, and the result is your 26 muscles begin to get a sense of fatigue through focusing and holding that for a period of time, all the way up to the largest one, which weighs several ounces more. And so if you want to spend anywhere between $55 and $125 to get either stainless steel, gold-plated, or platinum-plated chopsticks, go for it. I'm only angry that I did not think of this myself. Similar is Terry Warburton's PEAT. This is a practice exercise embouchure strengthening device. You put it between your lips, against your teeth. Once again, it's an isometric exercise, and it does strengthen the 26 muscles in addition to normal practice. These do not take the place of practice. But what I use them for is to show to my students exactly what it feels like when all 26 muscles are contributing to the formation of an embouchure. All 26 muscles being drawn into the hub as in a sneer. The term sneer is one that I use because when you do that, when you give someone a dirty look, you purse your lips and you bring all 26 muscles into a center point. This prevents the spreading of the lips into a semi-smile. This prevents the loss of muscle tone. Instead, what you're doing is you're gathering the muscles together. This is called a pencil. More specifically, an unsharpened pencil. I probably spent some money on this. I probably bought a pack of pencils for 39 cents or something like that. But I also use it to give my students a sense of muscles that focus into the middle. This is a straw. Actually, it's half of a straw. It came from Wendy's. Don't tell them on me. I don't want to get in trouble. But I use this for two purposes. One, to show once again the concept of bringing all 26 muscles into a focus, into a focal point. But in addition, for breathing purposes, to give my students a sense of what the aperture feels like and approximately how large I think the aperture should be. When I play the trumpet, there has to be a hole between the lips for the air to come through in order to create a vibration. So you can spend money on chopsticks, on peat, or you can get an unsharpened pencil, or the next time you're at Wendy's, and I like Wendy's because the diameter of the straw is larger, I think Wendy's has the largest straw for any fast foodery, and the bottom line is it's much more similar to what it's going to feel like when I'm playing the trumpet in terms of release of air. Questions? Lily.
So I have a quick question about sets and reps and time. So I know for strength training, like your biceps or something like that, they'll say do 3 sets of 12 reps or hold it for 30 seconds. Is there a particular time?
In terms of holding a device like this, that's a good question. It's basically up to the player. I will tell you, I'm in fairly good shape right now in terms of my trumpet playing. I haven't always been during the pandemic, but right now I'm getting ready for a recital and I've been practicing a lot. I'm in fairly good shape. I can start to feel my muscles reacting to this isometric exercise after as few as 10 to 15 seconds. So I'm not trying to do this to the point where it feels like my face is ready to fall off the bone. I'm doing this for probably 20 seconds, maybe as long as 30 seconds, and then I'm resting for several minutes. So this is not something that is constant. I've read some testimonials online for Pete, where there are trumpet players who are using this device 4 hours a day. I don't. I might use it for 10 to 15 minutes, but during those 10 or 15 minutes, it's actually in my mouth and my muscles are focused for a fraction of that period of time. This does not take the place of practice, but if you want to strengthen these 26 muscles, you can consider doing something like this. And the way you do it is teeth are essentially together. The teeth are closed, not when I play my trumpet, but for this exercise, the flat end of whatever device I'm using goes against my teeth, and then my lips wrap around it. And this is not about suspending a heavy weight above the ground. This is not about holding the pencil parallel to the ground. It's about what the muscles have to do in order to hold that in place. In fact, for many of my younger students, I encourage them to take their index finger and support the weight of the pencil because their lip muscles aren't strong enough to even hold that in place, that the pencil slips out of their mouth. So that's a very good question. And the answer is it develops over a period of time. But initially, maybe for 10 seconds, and as soon as you start to feel the muscles burn a little bit, then I would relax and cease doing it for 30 seconds. And then maybe for another 10 seconds later on, maybe for 15 seconds with a minute rest in between. Later on, maybe for 30 seconds. But I have rarely done these exercises for longer than a minute ever. Good. Other questions? So I'm going to share another screen with you and talk about why some notes are harder than others. I call these levels of energy. all of the notes that look like whole notes, this A, this D, this F, this A, this B natural, this C sharp, are all notes that are hard for trumpet players to be able to play. And the reason for that is they all follow a note that you play with no vowels. So the A follows this G, the D follows a C, the F follows an E. These are all notes that you can play using no vowels, including this B flat, which is the flat 7 of the open overtone series, and then C. The reason for this is the trumpet is an additive instrument. You add length of tubing when you play the trumpet. And I use this example. The very first note that most of my students, the very first note that I learned with any consistency is a second line G. that note. And then the next note a student learns is an F. An F is a G with this much additional tubing. So you don't do anything to create a difference between an F and a G except press this valve. And you all know what a trumpet valve looks like. It's a cylinder with holes in. And when you depress the valve, it redirects the air through a longer length of tubing. The next note most students learn is an E. An E is a G with this much additional length of tubing. So the easiest way to visualize this is a trombone. When the trombone slide gets longer, the pitch goes lower. When the trombone slide starts out and comes in, the length shortens and it goes from a lower note to a higher note. So pressing valves adds length of tubing. The result is a lower note. Then that trumpet student turns the page in their book and the next note is an A. An A is first and second valve, but an E was first and second valve. How does a student play two notes of the same fingering? And the answer, at least for me in my description to my students, is a different level of energy. This is where I think about my air going farther. So from this note, to that note, I'm thinking about the distance that my air is traveling, going from 4.5 feet to maybe 6 feet. I'm probably also thinking my air slightly higher. But most of the time we're told, well, you just keep trying harder and that note will come out. Trying harder usually means more pressure. Trying harder usually means changing the embouchure to try and figure out a way to make that note come out. Instead, what I tell my youngest students is make the air go farther, make the air go higher, and the result eventually is a new level of energy. Length of tubing means a lower note. In this case, more tubing, a higher note, a new level of energy. Now, for a trumpet player, life is great because very quickly they can play B flat, B natural, and C because all of those notes are part of the same level of energy. The next note that's problematic is the D. And only through trial and error will a D eventually come out, maybe, hopefully. Instead, I tell my students, make the air go farther, make the air go higher. Now, the problem with the overtone series, as you all know, is the higher you go, the closer the notes get. So the levels of energy start to get closer and closer together. A D allows you to also play a D sharp and an E. But then the next time you play an open E and go to an F, you're adding length of tubing. F is a new level of energy. G to A. All of these are alternately called breaks, resistance notes. There are many different ways to describe them. I refer to them as levels of energy, and the energy that needs to be created to take you across that next note is air that goes farther and air that goes higher. The types of exercises that I suggest my students play are several. Again, I talked about scales earlier. Scales are exercises that take you between the various levels of energy in a stepwise motion. And whether it's a chromatic scale or a major scale, you're talking about practicing scales every day. And I start in a range that's fairly easy for me. I start with G. By my way of description, G, A, B, C, D, E, F sharp, we're going across four levels of energy in that one scale. And so for young students who have not learned to make their air go far enough, who've not learned to make their air go higher, who have not developed their musculature, they're not going to be able to play this scale because it goes across those four moments where we go from less tubing to more tubing. We go across four levels of energy in that one scale. If they can't play a G major scale, have them play an F major scale. If they can't play an F major scale, have them play a C major scale and then a D major scale. But I use scales for many different purposes. One, finger dexterity, obviously, moving from valve combination to valve combination. Building endurance by playing scales repeatedly, ascending and descending. You can see from pianissimo to fortissimo, and so I'm building my sense of control over the instrument by playing scales at various dynamics. I always play these exercises slurred because adding articulation to this just adds a whole nother layer of problems to the development of this. I have my students practice scales slurred for years before we talk about articulating. And once I'm able to play a certain scale, a certain level of scale, I rest. Resting is very important. And then I play the next scale. I rest, I play the next scale. And I continue this until I can no longer achieve the next level of energy, or I can play to the very highest note that I want to accomplish. When I give clinics, almost inevitably, students say to me, how high can you play? They ask me, how high can you play? And my answer is, I don't know. I don't know how high I can play. I know how high I practice to. I know what note I own. And the answer in the old days was a G above high C. When I'm hired to be a lead trumpet player, I need to have that note. I have seen notes above G above high C in professional settings, maybe 8 times in the last 35 years. And almost always as an optional note. There are people who specialize in crazy high register, in what we refer to as the altissima range of the trumpet. Guys like Wayne Bergeron, who I mentioned earlier. You know, if you're going to become the next Wayne Bergeron and you're going to record the soundtrack for the next Incredibles movie, then maybe you need to develop your range above a G above high C. I don't live in that world. I don't live in that world. I play a piccolo trumpet where I have to have usually a G above high C. I play lead trumpet in jazz bands. I need to have a G above high C. So I work on my register to include that note. But I don't work higher than that because the answer is I don't really need those notes. I don't see them that often. And I don't have enough practice time to waste on doing them just to amaze and dazzle my friends. So for me, I'm going to rehearse in a practical way. I'm going to rehearse the exercises that I need to exercise that allow me to develop the range. And remember, at the start of all this, I said there are lots of techniques that I need to continue to work on. My lip flexibilities, which we'll talk about in a moment, my articulation, my multiple tonguing, my transposition, my improvisation. I don't have time to practice notes that I never get to play. And so I'm content with G above high C. And to be honest with you, I've not been practicing that high recently. So I probably don't even have a G above high C right now. I also play 5-note scales, not pentatonics per se, but just shortened versions of scales so that I can get to the highest note. And it says, repeat 2 to 3 times. The truth is I probably repeat it sometimes as many as 8, 10, 12 times. And this gets me across the levels of energy. I'm not getting along with A today. When I play repeatedly like that, whether it's a major scale, 1 octave, just what I was doing a moment ago. That's the same isometric exercise. In other words, holding my muscles contracted for a period of time as when I do this. Same exercise for my muscles, for those 26 muscles that form the embouchure, with the addition of air that's moving rapidly through the mouthpiece, creating the vibration that I need for this register. So I practice scales, either one octave scales or five note scales. And I practice lip flexibilities. I know we're starting to run short on time, and so I'm going to condense some of this information. Lip flexibilities are misnamed. You are not flexing your lips when you play lip flexibilities. What you're flexing are the 26 muscles that surround the lips. I tell my students to imagine that there is a piece of yarn glued to their lips. And once I've established my level of energy for the higher note, if I pull on the yarn, if I drop my jaw, if I go from my tongue being in the ah position to the oh position, then what happens is my lips vibrate slower. That's a lower note. When I let go of the yarn, when I put my jaw back to its original position, the higher note should come back out. Faster air, higher level of energy. Through practicing of scales, a higher level of energy is achieved. I've told many of my students this story before, but every year before the pandemic, I would be invited to several high schools to work with their trumpet students, and I would talk about finger dexterity, articulation, lip flexibility, and I would demonstrate each of those things. And I was working with a group of trumpet players at a high school several years ago, and I said, lip flexibilities, the motion between two or more notes without changing vowels. And the trumpet player in the front row looked at me and said, I hate you. Now, I took that as a compliment, because I think what he was saying was, I can't do that, and you just made it look really easy. Constant G air, air that's traveling 8 feet away from my body. One moving part. It's that simple. Most people want to make it harder than that. Most people want to make it more physical than that. And the answer is constant airflow, one moving part. So I practice lip flexibilities two different ways. One is a very, very narrow width of notes. In other words, two pitches. Or starting on the upper note and dropping my jaw for the lower note. And I practice these a lot. I practice these every day. I don't necessarily play to the highest of my range every day, but I practice lip flexibilities every day because these are the muscles that strengthen the 26 muscles that surround my lips. Sometimes I will practice larger interval. Constant airflow. And the bottom line is my air has already achieved a high C in terms of level of effort, even if I'm not playing a high C. So this is a high C. Why didn't the high C come out? Because I have my jaw dropped to the point where the low note comes out. So I practice lip flexibilities two different ways, wide intervals, wide ranges, and then very refined ranges, very, very limited ranges. later on, I skip partials. So right now, I think better to connect all of the overtones and not worry about skipping them. And again, I have this information fleshed out a little bit more in the handout, and I have some examples for you, and I will send that out to you very shortly. The last thing that I want to talk about is equipment. There are no shortcuts, and that includes equipment. I don't think that high school players should be playing beginner model trumpets. I think they should have advanced to at least an intermediate, if not a professional line instrument. Nor do I think they should be playing on a box 7C anymore because their lips are larger. When I talk to parents, it's always, when did your son or daughter start playing the trumpet? Fourth grade, fifth grade, seventh grade. Do they wear the same size shoes now as a 10th, 11th, 12th grader as they did when they were in fourth, fifth, or seventh grade? The answer generally is no. Why not? Because their feet grew. Are they wearing the same size pants? Are they wearing the same belt? No, they got bigger. Then why should they be expected to continue to play on a 7C mouthpiece and a beginner model trumpet? As a teacher, when I go out to give clinics, I look at where tuning slides are positioned. If they're out that far, that's a student who has overgrown their trumpet. That's a student who is, when they play loud, is being accused of being sharp, and that's the same thing as turning up the gain too far on a microphone. They're getting feedback. They're getting back pressure. They're getting resistance, and the result is louder is sharper. And then, of course, when they play softer dynamics, they're accused of being flat because the tuning slide is not designed to be out that far. If you can see where my tuning slide is, a half an inch to an inch is the typical length from the body of the instrument, not 3 inches. So high school students need to invest in a intermediate model, if not a professional model trumpet, because of the bore size. They should play a larger mouthpiece, larger than a 7C. I don't think high school students should be using lead mouthpieces or cheater mouthpieces or commercial mouthpieces. If they are, I hope that they have gotten them from a knowledgeable teacher, not, here, see how high you can play on this mouthpiece. Wow, you squeaked out a high E. You should use this mouthpiece. No. To a point, bigger is better when it comes to mouthpieces, but I also look at the size of the lips. I have a lot of college students, as I said at the top of the hour, who never play a 1.5C or a 2C Bach while they study with me because it's simply too big for them. I'm interested in more vibrating surface. I'm interested in a fuller vibration and a bigger sound as a result. So that's kind of all that I had to talk about today. I know that I haven't done a lot of high note playing yet, so. Played up to an F on the Man with the Horn recording at the top of the hour. So that's an F above high C. Yeah, and there's about my limit right now. I haven't been practicing above an E, as I said, because of my recital has me playing E's. If we get through this pandemic and the big band that I play with schedules a performance, I'll be working on my range up above an F because I know that music and I've got to have a couple of G's in the lineup that we'll play. But for me, it's methodical. For me, it's disciplined. For me, you have to be patient. You know, it would be great for me to pick up my trumpet now and go for a double high C, but the truth is I don't practice those notes any more than if I had a barbell here that had 200 pounds on it, I would not try and impress anybody by picking it up. I would probably hurt myself, and I'm trying to avoid that because I have other things that I need to do and want to do on the trumpet. So any questions? Anything at all that I didn't talk about? Anything that anybody wants to discuss?
I have one for you.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, when we're talking, you know, you're talking about even with the mouthpiece. Do you also have the weight of the mouthpiece on your lips even? You know, like you were saying, you're dropping your jaw. Do you have more weight on the bottom or the top, or it's equal?
Absolutely. Yes. Yes. It's equally distributed on the bottom and on the top. I do not use upper lip or lower lip more. That's one of the things that that these jutting jaw players do. They try, and as a result, they tend to have more weight on their lower lip. The problem is a lot of those guys have problems with TMJ. When you project your jaw and you have your teeth together and your jaw clenched, because of the resistance, because of the pressing over a period of time, you can begin to hurt yourself back here. And TMJ is damaging to the place where your jaw, your lower jaw, hinges to your skull. And so this is something that I'm trying to avoid. I'm trying to equally distribute. And again, like the spokes of a wheel, all 26 muscles are contributing to the embouchure. Both the upper lip and the lower lip are contributing to the embouchure. Just as if I were going to lift a barbell, I would do so with both arms and the weight equally distributed across the barbell.
My last one is, when you're working on scales, do you also focus on that they're using their slides to get the notes so they're in tune? So it's not only just the pattern of the scale, but the scale being in tune.
Yes, and in terms of slides, that's part of it. In the upper range of the trumpet, as with all the other brass instruments, there are also alternate fingerings. Well, and the truth is, woodwind instruments have alternate fingerings also to make certain notes better in tune. And so for me, for example, my high C sharp is much better in tune, just second valve. You can hear what happens when I play it second, first and second valve. My high D is better in tune open. And this comes through trial and error. I owned a trumpet many years ago where the opposite was true. I had to play C sharp first and second. I had to play high D first valve. In fact, high E flat, I had to play second and third, because when I played it second valve alone, it was too flat. It was just too flat. So I had to do second and third. I don't play that trumpet anymore because I didn't like having to use all those alternate fingerings. But moving slides, F at the top of the staff, tends to be sharp. A tends to be sharp. So I either move my first slide or I just play it third, which brings it down. So through experimentation, through working with a tuner, you kind of figure out. But the first step is to be able to play those notes. The second step is to be able to play them in tune. So once you have the ability to grow across those levels of energy, then it's more a matter of finessing and making sure that you're not on top of working to play those notes, trying to lip them in tune, because that creates fatigue, a lot of cracking of notes, and just inconsistency. So I'm looking to be as consistent as possible. So I will use slides, but I'll also use alternate fingerings to help bring those notes in tune. Any other questions?
I was going to say, here so quickly, an hour has gone by and we've had tons of really cool information. Can we give Dr. Eisensmith a round of applause for his help for it?
And for those of you who are local, if you want to follow up on this, just let me know and we can have a lesson specifically on the development of this information. I will send out the handout. As I was looking through my notes, I noticed a couple of misspelled words. So I need to fix my handout before I send it to all of you, but I will do that later today. And so you can look forward to getting that. If it brings up any questions, feel free to contact me and I'll be glad to explain. Going out, I have another recording, this one that was made with the IUP Jazz Ensemble several years ago, and it is Maynard Ferguson's arrangement of Rocky. So this is me playing the solo part. You can stick around and listen to it. Otherwise, thanks for attending, and we'll try and make this available on YouTube in the near future. But here is my rendition of Rocky. Thanks, y'all. Maybe it is. Here we go. Thank you. That was the IUP Jazz Ensemble. So thanks for attending. Hope to see you at the next one.